From Pune, this is the International Service in English.
Welcome to the next 30 minutes of program from Adventist World Radio.
Today in our program, we bring music from heritage singers and celestial singers.
Followed by a feature on You Are Not Alone.
Then a nature study on fish and birds.
Ending our program with a message on God's Word. I'm Natasha.
I'm Sharad.
And you are listening to Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope.
Here are the heritage singers with a song, It's a Wonderful Day.
A song on Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope for all.
Featuring on You Are Not Alone, we have Frederick Paul.
You are not alone. God's strong and loving hand is reaching down right now to grasp your weak and trembling one. He knows all about your present circumstances. And His voice is whispering, do not be worried and upset. John chapter 14 and verse 1. He stands ready to comfort and strengthen you, no matter what the need. One who has suffered greatly is Martha Snell Nicholson. Yet in one of her poems, she gratefully acknowledges God's promise in Matthew 28 and verse 20. Lo, I am with you always. Softly the promise steals, like sunlight into my shadows, and brightens and warms and heals my anguish of spirit, and horror of loneliness, flooding my heart's dark chambers, words that comfort and bless, strength for every need. In addition to God's presence, the Bible also promises that He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, He increaseth strength, Isaiah 40:29. This is why He invites us to commit our needs into His hands. Psalm 55 and verse 22 says, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and He shall sustain thee. Not just part of your burden or some of your care, but throw all your worries on Him, for He cares for you. 1 Peter 5 and verse 7. Light in your darkness. To countless individuals, life is a dark street, a meaningless riddle. But Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, has declared, I am the light of the world. John 8 and verse 12 says, whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness. Happy indeed is the person who, with the psalmist, can say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When thou saidst, seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Psalm 27, verses 1 and 8. If circumstances around you appear dark just now, remember that God is light and there is no darkness at all in Him. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5. God's invitation to you. Yes, someone cares for you. And right now is reaching down to grasp your hand. It is God Himself. And He that spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. If you will open your heart to His voice, which through the centuries has come to suffering humanity, you will hear the Lord calling, come to me, all of you who are tired from carrying your heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Matthew 11 and 28. Won't you come and find rest in Him? For the eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath all the everlasting arms. Deuteronomy 33 and verse 27. seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let us hold fast our profession, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 to 16.
Thank you, Frederick Paul, for sharing a nice thought through a feature.
Another number by Heritage Singers entitled, Reach Out to Jesus.
You are listening to The Voice of Hope from Pune, India.
Along with us, we are glad to have Jennifer, who will talk about fish and birds.
And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly about the earth." Genesis 1:20. On the fifth day of creation, God broke the silence of His world when He created all the sea creatures and the birds of the sky. Sea creatures of every description came forth at God's command. Picture yourself standing there by God's side and hear Him say, "Mammals of the sea, come forth." And the whales and the porpoises began to splash around. "Now I want fish." Then the sharks, angelfish, guppies, goldfish, salmons, bat rays, bass, yellowtails, marlins, cods, halibuts, swordfish, and other churned the waters. Next, "Come forth other sea creatures." So the octopuses, starfish, seahorses, crabs, lobsters, shrimps, and all the other kind of moving creatures began to swim in the water. "I want some more beautiful things in the water, and the sand dollar, sea urchins, corals, mollusks, and other sea creatures appeared. I would suppose by this time your eyes would be really bulging as you heard God speak and saw all these creatures come to life and the waters swarming with this new life." He spoke again, and birds began to appear in the sky, such as eagles, hawks, vultures, crows, ravens, strutting around on the earth, the ostriches, emus, peacocks, and flamingos spread their wings. Ground birds such as the quail, grouse, chickens, and turkeys began scratching the earth's surface. Singing birds, including the robin, sparrow, meadowlarks, and bobwhites, began their song. Paddling around in the water and flapping their wings were the many varieties of ducks, swans, coots, and geese. Little birds, such as the hummingbirds, wrens, titmice, and nuthatches, floated through the air from tree to tree. As these newly created birds came forth from the Creator's hand, they were perfect and tame. Fear did not exist, and they had nothing to be afraid of. God, in His love, had created them without fear. Thank God this morning for the wildlife in your world.
You heard Jennifer talk on Adventist World Radio. Now, before you listen to God's Word, we have a song by Celestial Singers entitled, "Why Do You Cry?"
Why do you cry when friends do forsake you? Why do you cry when pain fills your heart? Don't you know I'm standing right beside you? I'm your friend who will never break your heart. Why do you cry when friends do forsake you? Why do you cry when pain fills your heart? Don't you know I'm standing right beside you?
It's time to hear God's Word. We have Richard Wilson to give us a thought from God's Word on the topic, They Thought It Was Over.
I wish to share this message with you today. They thought it was over. There they crucified him with those four short words from John's Gospel. We have reached the climax of the story of salvation. It's a story of love so amazing, so divine, that although 2 millennia of Good Fridays have come and gone, we are no nearer to understanding it than were the believers who have gone before us. They crucified him. With those four short words, the Christian faith makes a radical departure from every other world religion. For Christianity alone dares to proclaim a God who died a criminal's death on an instrument of execution. There they crucified him, and that they thought that was over. It was over, done. Who thought it? Those responsible for it, those who simply wished him dead, those who didn't care much one way or the other, and especially those who had desperately hoped it would come to this. His disciples, his friends, his loved ones. What Pilate thought? Pilate thought it was over. The Roman governor had ordered crucifixion aplenty. Did he ever feel sorry for his victims? Did he give any thought to the physical agony of the ones he crucified? Maybe, maybe not. Whether he did or not, he added a touch of humor to the event. It wasn't the kind of humor that brings happy laughter, though it was dark humor, gallows humor, we sometimes call it. It was humor that mocks the one who are about to die, shames them, and compounds the horror. Pilate had an inscription put on the cross, Jesus of Nazareth, King of Jews. It was a sick joke. This pathetic, beaten, bruised human creature hanging on the cross was of all things the King of the Jews. You beaten down a pathetic people who have been conquered by Caesar's army. Here is your king. This is what happens to anyone who forgets who the real king is around here. And to make sure everyone got the punchline, Pilate had it written in Greek, in Hebrew, and in Latin. Not surprisingly, the religious leaders didn't appreciate the joke. They urged Pilate to do something, some editing. Couldn't you have the inscription read, This man said, I am the king of the Jews? Pilate's answer was terse. What I have written, I have written. Did you have any clue, Pilate, that eventually the joke would be on you? For you see, Pilate, the one who condemned to death, was indeed a king who once said, I, when I am lifted up from earth, will draw all men to myself. And now he is indeed lifted up. His throne is most unlikely one, huge piece of wood planted in the ground. But this dying Jesus is the most unlikely king. His kingdom is an eternal one. What you thought was over, Pilate has just begun. What Mary thought, hanging on the cross, the crucified one looks down and sees his mother standing there next to the disciple he loves. He says to his mother, Woman, here is your son. And he says to the disciples, Here is your mother. Jesus' mother also thought it was over. The fourth gospel records only two appearances of Jesus. Mother, during his ministry, she was there at the beginning for the first miracle Jesus performed at the wedding of Cana, and she was there at the end, when another kind of miracle altogether was unfolding. What had Mary been thinking and feeling as she watched Jesus go through his ministry of healing and teaching? Had she been apprehensive? Had she been worried that he was getting in over his head? Had she heard the rumors that his enemies were out to get him? Yes, surely. And now she must stand and watch as a child. She once nursed, once rocked him to sleep, is soon to draw his last breath. She didn't realize that a dying son was offering her a gift of eternal life. For he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whosoever lives and believes in me will never die. What the disciples thought. All Jesus' disciples thought it was over. All their hopes, their dreams of glory were shattered. Gone were the times when they had listened to Jesus as he spoke to the crowds, as he walked the roads with them, always teaching, constantly showing them signs of the kingdom. Never again would they see him reach out and touch the blind man's eyes and give him sight, break a few simple loaves into a meal for a multitude, or calm an angry sea. For Peter especially, such an ending was nearly impossible to bear. He who had promised to stand shoulder to shoulder with Jesus when the testing time came was devastated by his denial. Like the other disciples, he turned the tail and ran. Now that Jesus was dead, there was no possibility ever to ask his forgiveness, no chance for a precious yet broken relationship to be restored. As he contemplated what the cross meant, Peter simply could not imagine that it wasn't over. He couldn't conceive the possibility of resurrection. You and me. And Peter is anyone, even you and me, who faces the kind of desolation that is not able to see beyond the immediacy of pain. Our sin, our guilt, our grief can become so intense, so all-consuming, that it takes over completely. We may get to the point of feeling dead inside. Like everyone who was present on the day Jesus was crucified, you and I may think it is indeed over. What is my response? Your response? Is it tears? Perhaps tears for his agony, tears for our complicity in his suffering, tears for all the sorrows that assail us in this often grief-stricken existence of ours that some have called a veil of tears. Tears are understandable, tears are appropriate, but tears are not enough, and tears are not the last word. It isn't over until resurrection is the last word. The tears of Good Friday lead to the gladness of Easter morning. Something is over, all right. For the people of resurrection, what's over is the long night of despair. What's over is the fear that immobilizes our wills, guilt that cripples our relationship with God and with others, self-hatred that blocks us from becoming liberated. Joyous people God longs for us to be. Resurrection means that all the ills that plague us, even death itself, are swallowed up in the ending God makes possible, eternal life. Resurrection also means that we are set free to give our lives in service to the world that God so loves. Resurrection, people know their lives have meaning, have purpose. Take care of my sheep, the risen Jesus said to Peter, who had wept bitter, bitter tears. And he says it still. As you look at the cross, you are weeping for me. Are you weeping for yourself? I understand. But then, after the weeping, dry your tears and go take care of my sheep.
Thank you, Richard Wilson, for sharing God's word.
The Bible says in John chapter 5, verse 24, I assure you, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life.
Jesus himself promised that those who believed in him will be saved. With this, we come to the end of our program.
To know more on God's word, do write to us on
Adventist World Radio, Post Box number 17, Pune 411001, Maharashtra, India.
That is Adventist World Radio, Post Box number 17, Pune 411001, Maharashtra, India.
You could also email us on amc3@vsnl.com.
That's amc3@vsnl.com. I am Sharad.
I'm Natasha, signing off from Adventist World Radio. Do remember to tune in again.
Until then, may God bless you with good health, take care, and goodbye.